This will be the essentials of your autonomic nervous system. I am assuming some general knowledge here that you know the structure of a neuron, that you're familiar with this term neurocrine, which includes neurotransmitters as well as some other molecules. In this video, I want to talk about the relationship of the ANS with respect to the entire nervous system. Like, how does it fit? What controls it? Why is it so confusing? And what are the divisions? What are they and what do they do? All right, first of all, what's the relationship between the autonomic division and the rest of the nervous system? Okay, so here's the nervous system. We've got the CNS. That includes the brain and the spinal cord. Then we have the peripheral nervous system. We have the sensory or afferent pathways and the motor or efferent pathways. Sensory or afferent coming into the CNS, motor or efferent going out from the CNS. Okay, on the motor side, we have the somatic motor. That refers to neurons that control skeletal muscles. Okay, I'm going to use them as a point of comparison for the autonomic motor neurons, okay, because these people are more comfortable and familiar with. But what we're talking about today are autonomic motor neurons, the autonomic nervous system, which is comprised of two divisions, the sympathetic and parasympathetic, and that's what we're going to focus on today. Next, what controls the ANS? We're talking about primarily the midbrain, including the limbic system, especially the amygdala, the hypothalamus, the medulla, and the pons. Why is it so confusing? I'm going to say because there are too many neurons involved and also ganglia. Students hate ganglia. Okay, so we're going to compare this to the somatic motor division as promised. Somatic motor pathways include one somatic motor neuron that synapses onto skeletal muscle. You have experience with this. You can control your skeletal muscles. There's only one neuron in the efferent pathway, and that just makes sense. Students get the somatic motor division. Autonomic motor neurons, as you can see, are a little more complicated. First of all, there are two instead of one. And what is this thing? Okay, this is a ganglion, plural ganglia. And a ganglion is a collection of nerve cell bodies that lie outside the central nervous system. And you see them here, all of these yellow things, these are all ganglia. These are collections of nerve cell bodies. What they're for, we will get to in just a little bit. The ANS is also confusing because the vocabulary itself is confusing. Okay, let's go back to this. So we've got to be able to identify these neurons. We have the neuron before the ganglion, and we have a neuron after the ganglion. Okay, but we got to be more sciencey than that. So we're going to call this a preganglionic neuron and a postganglionic neuron. Now, there are two main options here depending upon where the ganglion is in the body. Option one is if the ganglion is close to the target. In that case, the preganglionic neuron is long and the postganglionic neuron is short. However, we have other ganglia that are close to the spinal cord, in which case the preganglionic neuron is short, but the postganglionic neuron is long. It just depends on where the ganglia are actually located. So let's get into the divisions because this will make more sense. We have the parasympathetic division and the sympathetic division. The vocabulary is confusing as well. Sympathetic comes from the Greek syn, meaning together, and pathos, meaning feeling or suffering. So early anatomists like Galen, believed that nerves allowed organs to work in sympathy or in coordination with each other. Now, later, more nerves were discovered that seemed to work in parallel or alongside the already named sympathetic nerves. So they were called parasympathetic, which literally means beside or near the sympathetic nerves. These names really reflect the historical development of this knowledge rather than like what they actually do. So understandably, the terms are confusing. So here you see the sympathetic nerves in red and the parasympathetic nerves in blue. What do the divisions do? Let's talk about the parasympathetic division first. This is known as the rest and digest system. The preganglionic neurons here originate in the midbrain, the medulla, and the pons, as well as the sacral region of the spinal cord. So you might see this referred to as the craniosacral division. The ganglia are located either in or near the effector organs. So that means the preganglionic neurons are going to have to be long and the postganglionic neurons are going to be short. So we can symbolize it this way. The primary effects of the parasympathetic division include all kinds of things that relate to what the body does when you are at rest or during normal, non-stressful activities. The sympathetic division used to be known as the fight or flight response. Now we have added freeze. So fight, flight, or freeze. Preganglionic neurons here originate in the thoracic and the lumbar regions of the spinal cord. So you might see this referred to as the thoracolumbar division. The ganglia are paravertebral. So break that down. Para means beside or near. So think about words like parallel or paramedic. So these ganglia, as you see here, run right along the spinal cord. So what does that mean? The preganglionic axons are short and the postganglionic axons will be long. So sympathetic pathways will look like this. The primary effects include all the things that happen to your body when you are under stress. So think about things that are extremely important for your survival. That's what the sympathetic division is about. So we've got the parasympathetic and the sympathetic. But what are the ganglia for? I promised you this. To answer that, we want to think about how the targets work. Ganglia allow for targets to work as a team. They're more like relay stations where signals can be integrated and modified. Some people think about it like a postal distribution center. Let's think about fear. Okay, so I looked up what most students are afraid of. Top fears, ready? So here they are. Let's take the top two, fear of failure and fear of public speaking. Think about what happens to your body when you're placed in a situation like, you know, taking a test or giving a speech. What happens to you? And more importantly, when do those things happen? And hopefully you get that when you're in a fight, flight, or freeze situation, everything mobilizes together. So if you're walking across the street, you turn and you see a bus, your body goes into survival mode. And all of the targets get that information instantaneously. Let's compare that with somatic motor pathways. The somatic motor division, which remember controls skeletal muscle, you do not want your effectors to work as a team. Think about fine motor control. If you're playing a harp or you're doing a surgery, you want to be able to control those individual muscles of your hand. This is not a team effort, so ganglia here would make no sense. So again, ganglia allow targets to act in a coordinated way, something that the somatic motor division would not want. Okay, there's one more pathway. It's the adrenal sympathetic pathway. So the adrenal glands, by the way, that just means near the kidneys, they're strange glands because the cortex, the outer part, is a proper gland, but the medulla, the meaty inside part, that's modified nervous tissue. So preganglionic fibers synapse onto cells in the adrenal medulla, which then release neurocrines into the blood. Most of it is epinephrine. Some of it is norepinephrine. Epinephrine used to be called adrenaline, and norepinephrine used to be called noradrenaline. You will notice that these effects basically enhance the sympathetic division that we already talked about. So it's part of that fight, flight, or freeze system. You see that there is no postganglionic neuron. There is no ganglion here. Instead, we have a preganglionic neuron that synapses into the adrenal medulla, which releases epinephrine and norepinephrine into the blood. And those will bind to receptors on targets throughout the body. How about quizzing yourself? What do you remember about the parasympathetic division? The sympathetic division? And the adrenal sympathetic division? If you're still here and you want more, I'm going to recommend this video, which actually goes into all of the neurocrines and all of the receptors for all of these pathways. As always, I hope that was helpful. Thank you so much for visiting the Penguin Prof channel. Please show me some love by slamming buttons below. I will see you in the next one. Good luck.